So welcome to the vote. I'm joined here today by Matt Webb, who's the educational convener at UNISON. So we're going to be talking about unions, which are a very important part of society, particularly in Brighton.
Absolutely.
So welcome to the vote, Matt. Just wanted to start off by just exploring UNISON. It's one of the bigger unions, or one of the biggest unions. So what's UNISON about? Who does it represent?
Okay, so UNISON is, I think it's probably the second largest union in the UK. We have about 1.4 million members, and our membership's going up nationally as well as locally, which is fantastic. We represent public sector workers, so that's local government workers, people who work in schools. We even have some within the NHS. We also have people within things like what used to be local government or used to be public sector. So that equally applies to energy companies.
Yeah.
Charities, third sector. So it's a pretty broad, really.
How many members? You've just got over 1.2 million?
1.4 million.
1.4 million.
Nationally,
yeah.
Yes.
So that's a lot of members. So
yes.
So it's really broad scope then. And what's it take to be a member? I mean, how much does it cost? And what are the benefits to being part of a union in like 21st century? Because obviously there's a lot of benefits. What are they specifically?
OK, Mark. So first of all, you know, in terms of what it costs and how you do it, you can just do it online.
Yeah.
Or a good way is just talk to your colleagues, find out, you know, who the union rep is, if you have a union rep. And that's a good way of getting a conversation going at work. In terms of cost, it's on a sliding scale. So, in theory, everybody should be able to afford to join.
Yeah.
So if you earn less, you pay less. If you earn
okay.
more, you pay more.
Yeah.
But it's equivalent to about an hour's wage a month or thereabouts.
Yeah. OK. Great. And where are you based in Brighton then?
Based at the Brighton Town Hall.
Yeah.
Centre of town.
And how long have you been involved?
Well, I first got involved in unionism loosely. Got involved with the student union as a youngster, which I found far more interesting than anything I was supposed to be studying, which is why I ended up really not finishing any college or anything like that. I got a series of jobs in factories and similar jobs, which are extremely grueling, very hard work. And to be honest with you, you're not treated very well in many sort of industrial things. And then I ended up getting a job for Nationwide when I was living in Bournemouth, and I got involved with the Nationwide Group Union, got a bit involved with them. And then when I moved to Brighton, I started working at City College, where I became a workplace rep. And I spent about 9 years or 8 years, or whatever it was, there before I started working with the branch.
Yeah. Why is being a part of a union important in today's society? I mean, you know, there's lots of different issues that we're confronted with, you know, freelance work, you know, 0 hours contracts. So what does being part of a union, how can that help someone that's on a 0 hour contract, for example? I mean, what have unions done for those workers?
Okay, there's a lot to go on there. So
yeah.
I think, first of all, what do you get out of a union? I mean, that works on many levels. I mean, on your immediate level, in your workplace, if you're in a union, you will have access to your branch, you'll have access to reps. So, you know, if you have an issue with your manager, say you're asking for some time off and your manager's going, well, no, you can't have that.
Yeah.
We can help get involved. You know, if you're being given a hard time, you're being expected to do things that you don't think's part of your job. Again, you take that to your union, and we can go in and we can ascertain whether that is a reasonable request or perhaps it isn't, and someone else needs to be doing that. Perhaps your boss should be doing that, and perhaps they're trying to offload that onto you. That's not unheard of. So there's all sorts of things.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if things can't get sorted out in immediate sense at work, we can put in formal complaints and what have you. We have access to a legal team. We have legal access like running water at a union branch. You have to. So that's also very important. And crucially, we need to make sure that your employer is acting within the framework of the right legislation, that they're not breaking the law, and that they're keeping to their own policies, because employers, out of sometimes ignorance, to be fair, and I mean that in a genuine word, ignorance, or just can't be bothered to, and it's your union who's going to be able to stand up with you and say, well, no, you need to do this, you need to do that.
Yeah. For me, I think the importance of unions is some people don't like having that kind of almost confrontation with their employer.
Mm.
They'd rather kind of someone else do that on their behalf. You know, sometimes it's not, there's a lot of job insecurity nowadays. So I think what the role that unions do, which is important, is can have those difficult conversations with their employer, which you might not want, you know, for obvious reasons, someone on a line. I think that collective bargaining is important in the workplace.
Absolutely,
particularly bigger organisations.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you're absolutely right, Mark. I mean, it's very difficult to have a conversation, especially in a smaller organisation or a smaller department, even in the council. It could be that you're actually quite very good terms with your boss, so it makes it very difficult when they say, when they ask you to do something unreasonable, or you have a problem with something, or you have a problem with a colleague. It can be very difficult, and I think sometimes people have a bit of a false idea of unions, you know, the idea of going in, thumping the table, turning the table over, you know. Yeah. It sounds like great fun, but it doesn't generally work like that.
Yeah.
Simply because we get a lot more for our members. We get a lot out of things for our members by having those conversations. And, you know, there is a time for confrontation, and you won't see eye to eye, but it's how you deal with that.
Yeah.
It's how the employer deals with that as well.
Yeah. And so your head office is in London, isn't it?
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes.
So who's the part of the leadership team up in London? Because obviously we know that we're going to Brexit, I think, in the second half. But
sure.
Obviously the unions have now become involved in Brexit, probably for a good reason as well. They've got a lot of power there. So who's part of your leadership team up in London?
Well, I don't have a great deal to do with the central office up in Euston.
Yeah.
It's on Euston Road. It's a fantastic. Fantastic building. Dave Prentice is our general secretary. He seems like a very decent chap every time I've encountered him. But yes, you're right. I think Brexit is something which is, regardless of what side of the fence you're on, you know, it's not simple. It's going to be very complicated, I think, whatever the outcome.
Yeah.
I think we're hitting on. We keep rolling out the cliches. I think the longer this is going on, the more we keep banging out these cliches of uncharted water and what have you, but it's kind of a cliche because it's true, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And so we'll talk about Brexit second half, but what are the other big issues that UNISON have been working on recently? I mean, what kind of issues have you been working on in Brighton? And I mean, do you just cover Brighton or is it the whole of the South East?
Well, I work for Brighton and Hove Unitary Branch, so that's the local government branch.
Yeah.
I deal predominantly with schools, so I'd say probably about 85% of my work is the schools. So, I mean, in terms of the schools, we've been making a big thing about going out to every single school in the city.
Yeah.
And we've been doing that for about 4 months now, and we've hit about half of them.
Yeah.
I mean, even me, it surprises me when I look at just how many schools there are, and we have thousands of members across schools. But it's been really wonderful. It's been a big task, but there are all sorts of things. I mean, the cuts across the schools in the last couple of years. I mean, I've been on the record in the local media denouncing the cuts to the schools and been going in with the councillors, some of whom I know you've spoken to recently and what have you, and Dan Yates. And it's very much a case-by-case thing. We're trying to fight these cuts however we can. We're trying to make sure that these cuts aren't costing jobs and, you know, it is the jobs of our members, of course it is. But it's also, you know, our members have kids who go to school in the city.
Yeah.
And, you know, in a few years' time, these people who are in our schools in the city, they're going to be running the city. So I think if people knew what was going on in schools across the city, there'd be a lot more anger.
And what are your main concerns? Is it just cuts or... Because we've had recently... I interviewed the top official in charge of schools policy just on Friday, actually. So our results in schools, GCSE and A-level results, have been very good.
Yes.
But you're saying that that's in spite of the cuts that have been made to budgets?
Absolutely. I mean, the other thing is we have to be very proud of the schools we have here in Brighton and Hove. You know, right from the governors to the school heads to, of course, the extremely hard-working teaching assistants and the caretakers and, of course, the teachers, who I don't represent, but, you know, I can say that they're hard-working, they are. I mean, they are fantastically hard-working people, incredibly hard-working, and I don't know how some of them do it. But, I mean, the issues are, I mean, as the staff numbers have been going down due to the cuts, the work doesn't go away. The work simply has to be done by less people in less time. And that's causing a lot of stress. We're seeing more and more people signed off with stress and those sorts of mental health illnesses and issues across schools. Less staff numbers. There's also the question of safety, especially in schools with special needs.
Yeah.
Incredibly challenging work. Challenging.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think our priority right now is making sure our members and the pupils are safe and that there is a reasonable level of safety throughout this, because you take the eyes off that for a minute.
Yeah.
There can be devastating effects.
Yeah. Do you do, just staying on topic of schools, do you do awareness campaigns in schools? Does UNISON work with children and students in schools? Do you have, like, an awareness programme for the importance of unions?
Not so much. I mean, we have discussed this before, and that's something that we've discussed in Brighton Hove District's Trades Council, was going around to colleges and speaking to youngsters as they're leaving education and as they're going into the workplace. So I think that's the real key point. A lot of people are leaving colleges, and universities for that matter, very well skilled in what they're going into, but perhaps not so well skilled on those certain issues that they're entitled to a certain amount of holiday, that they're entitled to a certain number of days off, that they're entitled to know exactly what their contracts are, their job description, they're entitled to a pay slip with a breakdown. Just those very fundamental things. But also in terms of, you know, what if somebody wants to make me redundant? What happens then?
Okay, Matt, that's it for the first half. Join us for the second half, where Matt and I are going to be talking about some of the policy issues that UNISON have been working on, some of their successes, and we will be mentioning Brexit as well. So join us for the second half shortly. Second half of the vote. I'm here with Matt Webb, who's the educational organiser at UNISON in Brighton. Welcome back for the second half.
Thank you, Mark.
So, Matt, we're just going to be talking about the successes of UNISON. What do you see as the main successes? Obviously, we can't go into too much detail, because some of those successes are behind closed doors.
Yes.
But in general terms.
Well, I mean, I'll start off locally quickly, Mark.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I talked about the huge challenge that austerity in schools has presented both unions and schools, school governors, and the councillors, the local authorities, everybody basically. Nobody's enjoyed the austerity. And I think, you know, there was one particular school which was in the papers a lot. You know, they were looking at cutting, I think, close to 60% of their support staff last year.
Yeah.
And, you know, at what point does it come that you start boarding up the windows? That's the question, when you're getting rid of that number of staff. And UNISON, and fair play to the GMB, also a good union.
Yeah.
And the councillors, Dan Yates.
My dad
Yates.
Was part of the GMB.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly. And Dan Yates was involved, and we got school governors involved.
Yeah.
And we all sat around a big table, and things got a little confrontational once or twice, but the bottom line was we saved so many jobs. Now, there were still some redundancies, but they weren't our members, and it was vastly, vastly smaller would have been proposed. So those sorts of things, they really are successes.
Yeah.
But there's also in terms of, I had a particular case which stands out to me of somebody being bullied in their workplace by two members of staff who were senior to them. And we tried to solve it informally and we couldn't, so we put in a grievance, and it was a school. And this went on for months. It was very, very difficult, particularly for the member who was already feeling very stressed out, upset, put upon. And they showed amazing courage, really, and saw it through. And the process works. That's what I'm saying. The process works if you use it correctly. Yeah. And it's more of a challenge for the member.
Yeah.
You know, it does take courage to do it. But the outcome was absolutely perfect.
Are you seeing an increase in those kind of bullying claims, what you've seen an increase of most, is it kind of people suffering stress at work or bullying? Is it stress?
I think, you know, bullying, those sorts of things, you know, that it does happen to some degree, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And I think the main thing is that people bring it out into the open and they get it sorted out sooner than later, because it's usually when it's been going on for weeks, months, years, that's when you end up with serious problems. And it can toxify an entire workforce if it's allowed to. So it's nipping these things in the bud. And again, that's a good reason for you to get the union involved sooner than later.
Yeah.
So we can nip it in the bud. And that's in everybody's interest. Certainly the boss, the employer, that's what the employer will want. So absolutely. But in terms of national success, there was a fantastic, without getting getting political.
Yeah.
Chris Grayling, the guy who's responsible for our fantastic train system.
Yeah.
He's got skills beyond that, would you believe, Mark? He was also Minister of Justice, I think it was.
Yeah,
he was good at that as well. He basically ruled that unless you had a big wad of money, a capable right and a big cheque, you couldn't go to an employment tribunal. An employment tribunal is basically a law, a court.
Yeah, there were
anything work-related.
For that.
Yes.
Yeah.
So he said, unless you had £1,200, you couldn't use it. So
yeah,
that's a bit like saying to someone, you can't go to the police or have access to the courts unless you're rich enough. So that meant that anyone under a certain working threshold of money, income, would not have access to that. So UNISON challenged that. It took 4 years.
Yeah, I remember that. And were you successful in that?
We were.
Okay.
It took 4 years.
Yeah.
The High Court said it was unconstitutional, and the government had to pay back £27 million to everybody they'd fleeced money from. Now, what I think is particularly wonderful about that was it wasn't UNISON as in some sort of otherworldly organisation or something miles away. It was every single member. Every member we have in this city helped do that, because no single one of us could have taken the government to the High Court.
Yeah.
And so none of us have the money to do that, but that's the purpose of the union.
It's a good example. I think another, as we were saying beforehand, with Brexit, I think what unions are good for as well is reaching a compromise. We're in need of a compromise with Brexit. Where do you see the union's role is in Brexit in kind of broad-based terms? Obviously, the Prime Minister's spoken to the main union leaders, including Dave Prentice, I believe.
Yes.
Where do you see, where's that role for the unions? Particularly if Brexit does happen, post-Brexit, workers' rights, are they going to be form part of the final deal, whatever that looks like? Who knows what that's going to look like? But, you know, are workers' rights under threat post-Brexit and before we leave the EU, if we do leave the EU, do you see them being reinforced in any legislation?
OK, so your first point, I think, I think workers' rights have been getting eroded. I mean, we've only got to look since 2010. We've seen a raft of anti-trade union bills. We saw them trying to remove the right of working people to access justice at work, and all of these things continue. If we leave the EU and a no deal thing, and we're literally left to the will of the current government, I predict an acceleration in the things that we've been seeing in the last 8 or 9 years. But I mean, in terms of what the union can do, we are simply there to represent our members. So, do the unions have all the answers to the Brexit? Of course not. Of course we don't.
Yeah.
We need to make sure that whatever happens the other side, whether we're in, we're out, we're still going to be subjected to this horrific austerity. We need to make sure that our terms and conditions aren't being compromised. We need to make sure that we're still entitled to not be sacked on the spot, because that's what a lot of the lobbying is suggesting. When they're talking about freeing up red tape for employers, red tape sounds awful, doesn't it? Sounds like paperwork for paperwork's sake. But what they're referring to is your terms and conditions. Your right not to be sacked without reason. Your right to not be sacked simply because you're black or your sexual persuasion or your political... You know, so that's really what we need to be looking at. We need to make sure that the current terms and conditions we have are not being taken away from us. And better than that, Mark, we need to improve on them. You know?
Yeah, and I think there is a good chance that might be reflected in existing legislation. Do you think that the unions have got a role in the wider kind of consensus that's hopefully Parliament will reach at some stage? Maybe not in time for tomorrow, but hopefully there's some kind of consensus and we can move forward. Do you think that unions will play a big role in that?
Well, I think trade unions and all the people in those trade unions, whether the establishment like it or not, of course we do. You know, because, you know, the trade unions are powerful. I mean, we are. And we're getting more powerful. We're getting more members.
Yeah.
And our members do feel very strongly about many things. It made me sort of, well, not laugh out loud, but it made me smirk when Theresa May met with the trade union leaders to try and get them on board with her Brexit plan.
Which was last week.
Yeah, it was last week.
Yeah.
And I was surprised. But of course, I know why she wanted to. But of course, what they wanted was they wanted reassurances along the lines of what I just outlined.
Yeah.
And I know, and you know, I think most people would know that she was never going to give them that.
Yeah. Well, I think at the moment there are some. I'm not sure if the workers' rights. There is an amendment. I think John Mann MP might be putting forward an amendment to workers' rights.
Right.
But I think, I'm not sure, no one really knows what went on in those discussions, but I think that workers' rights will form part of that final agreement if we do get a final agreement that goes through.
Mm.
But do you have hope for that? Because we should say here, I think that the background to this is that a lot of EU legislation enshrines workers' rights, and this is why there's been a lot of concern about that. So
that's right.
When we leave the EU.
So. I'm very cynical. Very cynical, simply because on the track record, this government and the Conservative Lib Dem coalition before it really ramped up the fight against working people and trade unions. They really, really have. I'm cynical because, I mean, if there is something written in, like John Mann's amendment, as well might be the case, I don't know, that could happen.
Yeah.
What happens after that? What happens after that? Because they can't simply write away a load of EU legislation.
Yeah.
Even if we've gotten away with not adhering to much of it anyway, such as a working time directive, we've never really taken that on board in this country.
Yeah. We had previously had an opt-out on that, didn't we?
We did. Yeah. So it's not like we were all completely subjected to the will of you. But what makes me worried is something like that can be offered in one sense and then it can be taken away very quickly in the other.
Yeah. Just lastly, just before we finish up, what do you see the future of unions are? Are they still going to be relevant in 10 years' time, 50 years' time?
Yes, well, I think as long as there is the potential for there to be a disparity, an unfair weighting of power between an employer and an employee, there will always be a need for trade unions. We have, be absolutely honest, we have witnessed a slow decline in trade union membership over the last several decades. However, promising, I mean, last October, UNISON signed up more members in 1 month than ever before.
Yeah.
We're also seeing the BFAWU organising in areas which had been always unreachable by trade unions, McDonald's. And we've got the IWGB organising Deliveroo riders.
And you've had some court successes there.
Absolutely. So I think we've got a very, very optimistic and a very bright future because they're youngsters. They're much younger than I am.
Yeah.
And they're getting involved, they're getting active, they're taking the fight to the employers, particularly the worst employers. So I think there's a very bright future. If, next time you go to support the pickets, go and support the McStrike, go and support the delivery riders.
I do remember we covered that, latest TV to cover those strikes. Matt, thanks for coming in.
Lovely.
Been a joy.
It has.
And all the best for the new year as well.
Thank you, Mark.
So, Matt, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Cheers.